the genres that films are inserted into tends to reflect their status and legitimacy as art. And few genres are so consistently branded as low art, if art at all, than the genre of horror. Evidence of this can be seen in how so many films labeled as horror can just as well be placed within categories of thriller, drama, or that most prestigious of horror labels, psychological. Whether a film is a horror movie or a psychological thriller seems to, in a considerable way, come down to that film's aura of prestige. Defining a concept as absurd and arbitrary as prestige is its own vast tangent altogether, but like realistic gore effects, I think we all know it when we see it. Or at least we like to think we do. But although horror is a mountain of trash, within all that gorgeous trash are gems aplenty. The horror genre does have prestigious titles. Even horror subgenres have films of high prestige. However, there is one genre of film which is largely defined by its lack of prestige. Its complete lack of anything anyone could or should call art. The ignoble refuse of cinema. Exploitation film. Exploitation films are popularly conceived of as being tacky Z-tier movies who sell themselves on the often unrealized promise of shocking depictions of taboo subjects.
But beware, the sweetest kittens have the sharpest claws. For your own safety, see faster, pussycat. Kill, kill.
But to label a film as exploitation is often more dismissive than descriptive. In truth, what could be called exploitation film encompasses more types of film than is often understood. It could be argued, even, that the genre of exploitation has been mainstream for decades. Exploitation film is sometimes strictly defined as films inherent to a certain era and a certain method of production. Exploitation cinema is perhaps most often associated with the B-movies that flourished in the 1960s and 70s, and the offshoot subgenres that came with it, such as sexploitation, blaxploitation, or Bruceploitation, that last one being fake Bruce Lee movies. However, exploitation films can be said to have existed since the silent era, and not only did they deal in taboo subjects, but they often marketed themselves as educational. This classic era of exploitation film can be said to have lasted between the 1920s and the 1950s. And their educational promise is often what allowed them to be screened in the first place, with some even having been commissioned by the U.S. Army.
Into promiscuous relations. Then, on the other hand, if we teach them the beauty of a healthful, normal marriage, the spiritual satisfaction of rearing children, we shall have accomplished our aim. And our younger men and women will soon find themselves fit for the glorious state of God given matrimony.
I believe you are right, Mr. Lorenz. The prudish eluding of the facts of life are...
Many of these films could easily be canonized as precursors to sexploitation, but there were also exploitation films dealing with drug use, recent crimes and tragedies, burlesque, and sundry vices. Like the exploitation films to come, these earlier exploitation films were films made quick and cheap, and were sometimes even just older exploitation films given a new name and a fresh marketing campaign. But the appeal of exploitation films were not solely in their promised sleaze, but also the spectacle their screenings brought with them. As David Roche puts it, the ballyhoo surrounding the event was instrumental in drawing audiences. Exploiteers suggested local displays, sold themed books, included nurses and strippers, and invited so-called specialists to give lectures. Audiences probably saw these movies just as much to learn about shameful, taboo subjects as to enjoy the sexual titillation and carnivalesque atmosphere of the show. The films produced during the classic era of exploitation are incredibly tame by today's standards, and that is also in part why they went away. The films of this older era existed in the time of the Hays Code, as well as the censorship laws preceding it. But the authority of the Hays Code would begin to decline in the 1950s, and it would be completely abandoned in 1968. An eruption of exploitation film followed in the wake of this decline, and in this opportunistic new wave of exploitation, many attempted to push the boundaries farther than ever before. But although this sparked the era of exploitation film the label is most known for, the line between low-budget exploitation film and film in general had begun to blur, in both production and subject matter. Many films now considered among the classics of American horror fit perfectly into the mold of low-budget exploitation trash. And even nowadays, many popular films fit neatly into the category of classic exploitation. Films about recent tragedies, serial killers, or films based on true events remain immensely popular and are employing the same antediluvian tricks of the classic era of exploitation cinema, the only difference being their budget and their marketing. Exploitation may well be among the most haphazard genre definitions around, in film or otherwise, and yet I think we all have an image in our minds of what it is, even if the quality of that image is likely very poor, perhaps a bit sketchy, maybe racist, definitely sleazy, and probably delightful.
If you see him, send him here.
I'm a militant queen.
Won't I do, officer?
But none of that actually describes the film this video is actually about. Least of all could this film be described as delightful. This is a film frequently dismissed as an exploitation film, but one I find exceptional in ways few movies are or would ever attempt to be. A film made a decade after the end of the exploitation boom and on the other side of the world from it. A film about a thoroughly human ideology. The ideology of cruelty. Men Behind the Sun is about the final months of Unit 731, the head unit behind Japan's biological weapons research program, from here on simply referred to as the BW program. The film follows the goings-on within the unit's research facility in Harbin, with special attention paid to the founder and director of the BW program, Shiro Ishii, as well as the recently arrived youth corps, as they are trained to operate under Unit 731. The film was directed by Mu Toon-fei, often credited as T.F. Mu, a man born in China, raised in Taiwan, and who had made films in Taiwan, Hong Kong, and mainland China before making Men Behind the Sun. Mu was no stranger to grisly depictions of violence and had tackled difficult subject matter before, especially in his absolutely gruesome film Lost Souls, released in 1980. Neither was he a stranger to political subject matter and social critique, something he often snuck into his more commercial films. But the film preceding Men Behind the Sun was his 1983 film Little Heroes, which was a family film and became the highest-grossing movie in Chinese history at the time. Although the production of Men Behind the Sun was controversial, as it was believed capable of putting a strain on the relationship between China and Japan, Mu, who set out to fund the film out of his own pocket, got a Chinese investor and, after meeting with Chinese officials, was granted free use of the Chinese army as extras, including army equipment. This meeting with the Chinese officials and the concerns over the film's potential diplomatic strain is what inspired the quote in the film's opening: "Friendship is friendship, history is history."
That's the argument with government.
Yeah.
The government says, no, we have friendship
with
the Japanese very well.
Yeah.
I say, well, you talk about your friendship, I talk about history.
Yeah.
That's why I put this in.
I could probably spend this entire video talking about the life and career of T.F. Mu, and we will return to him now and then, but I also don't really need to. Much of the footage used here comes from a documentary released in 2010 called Black Sunshine, directed by J.L. Carosa. I don't agree with everything said in the documentary, especially when Carosa compares Men Behind the Sun to Goodbye Uncle Tom, of all things, which is a comparison so heinously slanderous it hurt my soul a little bit. But besides this minor instance of Carosa doing Mu dirty, the documentary is an absolute treasure, and you're doing yourself a favor by watching it. I've provided a link to it in the description. To slot Men Behind the Sun into the genre of exploitation film is in many ways to cram a non-Western film into a distinctly Western genre. From what I can gather, the film is regarded as an exploitation film more so for its reputation than anything else. The film had close to no marketing at all, and there was certainly no ballyhoo surrounding it, apart from it allegedly causing heart attacks in some of its viewers. This is not to say the association is without grounds. The film is reminiscent of both a classic era exploitation film and the boundary-pushing variety that emerged in the 1960s. It was a cheap movie, made very quickly, and it has a fairly explicit educational intent and message. It is also concerning a subject taboo in more senses of the word than most, and it is not lacking in some, if not the most gruesome depictions of violence and gore ever submitted to film. Considered as an exploitation film, Men Behind the Sun is perhaps a platonic ideal of the genre in all its temporal iterations. It pushes not just the boundary of what can or should be put to film, but also attempts to educate the viewer and understand a subject of such tremendous horror only a fragment of it can actually fit into a film of any kind. I think Men Behind the Sun succeeds in its endeavor, not only due to its educational intent, but because of how it portrays violence, as well as its attempts at interrogating the ideology behind such violence. One way in which the film frequently tackles its difficult themes is through the use of metaphor and symbolism. Admittedly, employed in ways so heavy-handed, they only barely qualify as either. And an especially relentless example of this are the many scenes involving the Youth Corps. The Youth Corps are in the very first scene of the film, waiting around in the harsh winter cold for their transport to arrive. As they do so, they find what appears to be a homeless boy eating a boiled yam. The children try to give the boy some sushi, but the boy refuses. In response, the children attempt to force the sushi into him, violently, but to no avail. The boy spits it all out and walks away into a snowy expanse. The metaphor is hardly subtle. To the children, they are here in a lesser land with a lesser people of a lesser race, and their Japanese culture is a gift to these people. Their culture is the superior one. It should be received with grateful, obedient arms, and when it is not, it will be forced on them for their own good. This is nationalistic imperialism in its most straightforward depiction. But there is another layer to this scene, a layer just as blatant but containing a truth unfathomable to the Youth Corps. This local boy, dressed in tattered furs, sitting in a ramshackle shelter eating a boiled yam, this boy is superior to the Japanese. Not in culture, not in race or ideology or creed, because none of that actually matters. No, this boy is superior in dignity. That quality so desperately treasured by those who cast themselves, like the Japanese did, in the role of the civilized. The Japanese invade his dwelling, gang up on him, assault him, jam food into his face, and this boy stands up, unshaken, unflinchingly, stares down his abusers as he slowly ejects their food, and then he walks off into the cold. The Japanese, in their well-made heavy coats, cannot bear the grim cold of a Manchurian winter, but this local boy, dressed in worn furs, which, from the perspective of the well-coded Youth Corps, is a symbol of primitivism if ever there was one, this boy walks off into what looks like a barren tundra, like he's taking a leisurely stroll. The cold climate here being used to show how completely foreign and out of their depth the Youth Corps, and, by extension, the Japanese truly are. And, even more so, the whole scene shows us how thoroughly blind they are to any perspective or experience other than their own. The so-called Manchurians are not aliens. The Japanese have, entirely through their own efforts, made themselves alien to their fellow humans. Even their violence, the one thing used to declare superiority over their inferiors, does nothing but strip them of their thin facade and expose the indignity which motivates their actions. But not long after this, we find ourselves with the Youth Corps once again. They are about to take the risk of retrieving a small ball that was taken from them by a superior officer. Bravely, they head out for it in the night, but are caught in the act. The boy who went for the ball is hunted down and shot at, only to fry on the electric fence in his scramble to escape. This is no accident. Not really. If the fence was not there, then a bullet would have done the same. The boy's death is not mourned by those who fired at him. We here begin to see the true face of a superior nation and culture. The children of the Youth Corps are not here to be children or to be people. A superior nation has room for neither, It only has room for subjects. The Youth Corps is frequently subjected to both physical drills and desensitization training, but throughout the film they remain among the few sympathetic Japanese characters. Unlike many of the adults, especially unlike their superiors, the children of the Youth Corps retain their empathy. What they witness even expands it, and they commit acts of heroism, selflessness, and camaraderie in a way their superiors do not. This character of the Youth Corps is what makes them such poor soldiers. The children are a resource, a material to be used by those who rule them. Their empathy and bravery is undesirable, even dangerous to the nation. This is no more apparent than when the children of the Youth Corps are taught how to think about and treat their victims. The victims of Unit 731 were infamously referred to as Maruta, literally meaning log. Here, the children are given sticks, told their victims are not victims at all, not even people, just wooden logs, and they are told to beat the logs. And so they do. Much later in the film, we find the children plotting revenge for one of their friends. They take up sticks and beat their superior in the same way he instructed them to beat the Maruta. Much of what the Youth Corps are made to do is consistent with what is now known about the Japanese BW program. Back in the 1980s, when the film was researched and produced, what information existed was scattered across languages and regions, and much of it remained intentionally hidden from the public. On top of this, much of the information and evidence had been purposefully destroyed.
I had contact with a lot of people, local people.
Yeah.
I heard the story of
731.
I said, well, that's important thing.
Yeah.
I said, any books? No books, just rumors.
Yeah.
Then I start digging.
T.F. Moo spent years researching the subject, acquiring documents from Russia, and having his wife use her American citizenship to dig up information in the United States National Archive. Moo even went to Manchuria to interview the locals. He also talked to previous members of Unit 731. The higher-ups of Unit 731 were in high-ranking government positions and the like, and many of them thought the BW program did nothing wrong, or that they didn't go far enough. But the members of Unit 731 Moo did become acquainted with were former members of the Youth Corps, who had lived with immense guilt and shame ever since. Moo even screened the film at Tokyo University with former Youth Corps members in attendance. The reason for this was because the students of a previous screening did not believe any of what they were seeing, and the former Youth Corps members were there to testify as to the legitimacy of the film. Beyond this, there was only a single screening of the film in a Japanese cinema, after which a Japanese right-wing party threatened to burn it to the ground, and it became dangerous for Moo to remain in the country. Moo was permanently blacklisted from Japanese cinemas as a result. Much more is now known about the Japanese BW research program than when the film was made, but even so, the film is remarkably accurate in its historical details. It was even shot where Unit 731 operated, including using one of its surviving buildings.
You see the 731 building. That was actually the real building?
Real building.
That you guys actually shot at? Wow.
Yeah, this is the high school now. They had to put the name, the school's name, I think, all out and put the Japanese back. One day, the old lady come to our school. Oh, my God.
You're back.
I heard they're going to come back. I didn't expect that soon.
What the film lacks in historical accuracy often comes from the film's understandable lack of scope due to its running time, the limits of what can be convincingly rendered, and how the film contracts some historical events for the sake of narrative progression. A good example of this comes towards the end, where the film uses the invention of ceramic germ bombs as a kind of narrative climax before the evacuation of Manchuria, making it seem as though the facility had to be abandoned in the nick of time. Ceramic germ bombs were a thing. They were tested in the manner shown in the film, and the director of the BW program, Shiro Ishii, was rather proud of them, and even flew some germ-bombing missions himself. But in reality, Unit 731 had been using a variety of ceramic germ bombs for years at this point, and even invented many other ways of transmitting disease. This had resulted in the deaths of hundreds of thousands of civilians, not including the victims of human experimentation. And human experimentation was not isolated to Unit 731. There were many units and many facilities across the conquered territories, and biological warfare detachments were even a part of the Japanese army across its many theaters of war. This brings us to a topic inevitable in any work concerning the Japanese BW program. That same man, Shiro Ishii. Shiro Ishii was an eccentric sack of shit born into extreme wealth and privilege. He was an accomplished doctor and medical researcher who doggedly pursued the establishing of a biological weapons research program. To say he spearheaded the creation of the BW program and its human experimentation is an understatement. In fact, expansive funding for the program in its early stages came about because Ishii stormed into the home of the finance minister of Japan at the time, Korikiyo Takahashi, brandishing a large flask. Ishii claimed that the flask was full of cultured cholera bacteria and threatened to pour it all over the finance minister's kitchen. But Takahashi stood firm. Ishii was to have no additional funding, and so instead of dousing the finance minister's kitchen in cholera bacteria, Ishii refused to leave until his program was funded. He was there for 24 hours. Most Japanese citizens would likely be thrown in jail for the rest of their lives for this kind of stunt. Shiro Ishii got 100 million yen in added funding. To summarize, the crimes against humanity committed by Unit 731 and the BW program partly came about because a spoiled rich kid had a temper tantrum. Shiro Ishii is a person who is easy to focus on. He is somewhat of a larger-than-life character, and the film does get much of that right. His drinking and womanizing, his obsession with achievement and prestige, his selfish pride, petty self-aggrandizement, flagrant corruption, and secret cowardice are all here. There is even a scene showing Ishii drinking filtered urine, which was very much a thing. I'm not sure if he ever did it the way it is shown in the film, but he gained some wealth and fame by pushing a water filter he invented for the army, humbly named the the Ishii filter. When trying to sell this to officials, he would demonstrate its effectiveness by urinating into the filter and then drinking his own filtered urine in front of the officials. Something he even did in front of Emperor Hirohito once. It is due to Shiro Ishii that BW research facilities were officially designated as water purification research facilities. I do love this scene though, when Ishii comes up with the idea of ceramic bombs after a geisha knocks over a bowl of gore stones. Then it immediately cuts from this naked, rapey creep softly laughing to himself over a broken bowl to Ishii in full regalia and entourage, marching on with all the flair of dignity and authority. He's so full of himself and just goes full eccentric showman. In juxtaposing these two scenes, the film very quickly shows us the full breadth of this awful human being whilst mocking the theater of military authority. It's just wonderful. And the film is full of these small moments that are strangely devastating. In one scene, some of the youth corps are invited over for dinner on a Sunday. With them is one of the soldiers, and one of the youth corps members gets into an argument with this soldier over whether or not the Maruta are human beings. The soldier thinks they are. The youth corps member, only recently made to beat them, thinks they are not. And then the host's wife comes in with imported fruits and tells them, "It's Sunday. Let's not talk about business." The youth corps member who so adamantly argues for the dehumanization of the Maruta is called Ishikawa. Ishikawa becomes one of the more prominent characters in the film, and we will return to him in time. The soldier who argues for the Maruta being human beings will later in the film also spare one of them and attempt to smuggle them out. This reluctant soldier is, in some ways, an older version of Ishikawa. He is what Ishikawa truly is, and what he will eventually admit to. Ishikawa is in denial. The reluctant soldier has been here too long to be in denial. The pairing of documented history with an exploration of humanity is a constant in the film. And it is just as evident throughout the film's many scenes of human experimentation. The way violence is portrayed in these scenes is, I think, somewhat unusual. Much of the violence is incredibly brutal and hard to watch, but the film often takes the side of the doctors in its portrayal. Through its cinematography, we see these experiments as they are seen by the people performing them. We often see subjects through something, such as glass, or the camera is distant, taking an overview position. We often see and hear the cries of pain and horror from the victims, frequently in typical close-ups, but there's no shaky cam here, no disturbing music or any music at all, no tricks to heighten the drama and misery of the scene. The screams of pain and horror are juxtaposed with the calm nature of the facility's staff. The experiment continues, the scientists and soldiers unperturbed by what they are doing. Just another day on the job. This was the case not just at the Harbin facility, but throughout the many units of the BW research program. We do not see the true extent of these experiments in the film, nor many of the worst ones, such as the injection of horse blood, which caused its victims to rot from the inside out over a period of weeks. But among the most common and most horrific were the live vivisections, which were done with regularity and most often without any form of anesthesia. Not only that, but BW units would do field tests in villages and perform live vivisections on site before burning the village to the ground. Many of these vivisections were done for no more reason than as a training exercise for civil and army doctors. Live vivisections are mentioned in the film, and we will get to one of them shortly. But, understandably, the vivisection of a conscious victim would be difficult to portray on a film with any convincing realism. In fact, many of the scenes of violence we see in the film are not done with typical props or special effects. They are real, at least as close as they could be. Many of the bodies and body parts were taken from the local morgue. The infamous scene where a woman has her arms frozen, sunk into hot water, and the skin pulled off of them is something that was done with regularity at Harbin. There was even an entire added facility constructed to do human experiments involving freezing and thawing in an attempt to develop new ways of combating frostbite. An urgent matter at the time, as the Japanese believed a war with the Soviets was soon to come. This woman is actually the director's niece, and under that coat, she's holding on to the ends of a pair of actual corpse arms. Another infamous scene involves a cat being killed and eaten by mice. This scene is also, to some extent, real. The cat was apparently drugged and was perfectly fine afterwards, although they did sadly kill off the mice. But the most difficult of these scenes involves the vivisection of a child. This child is a recurring character in the movie, and Kawasaki coaxes one of the youth corps members to bring the child in. That youth corps member is Ishikawa, and he convinces Ishikawa that no harm will come to the boy. The truth is, of course, that Kawasaki is offering this child to the doctors so they can put the child under, cut him open, and take some of his organs as a kind of medical trophy. All we hear in this scene is the work of the doctors and the beating of the child's heart. The child is then dumped in the corpse wagon like so much refuse, and Ishikawa is made to wheel his butchered friend to the crematorium. This event is what truly tips Ishikawa over, and the whole youth corps stands behind him, and this leads to the scene previously mentioned, where they band together, ambush Kawasaki, and beat the shit out of him the same way he made them beat the Maruta. But what we, the audience, have just seen, knowingly or not, is the actual autopsy of an actual child. It was a local boy who had died shortly before this scene was filmed. Mu got permission by the parents to shoot the beginning of the autopsy. What we see here are actual police coroners conducting an autopsy, wearing the actor's costumes. And the close-ups of organs being removed were done using a pig. This, let's call it, approach to realism is admittedly upsetting, even morally or ethically sketchy. But there is a part of me that is grateful for this film. Because as a film attempting to show us historical reality, Men Behind the Sun is tremendously successful in being a complete failure. And that's what's so horrifying about it. The film truly shatters the boundaries of what could or should be put on film, and yet what we see in the film is extremely mild in comparison to what was actually done by the BW research units. In Men Behind the Sun, the gore and violence shown serves many different purposes in the film, and often at the same time. The violence never exists just for the sake of it. The scene wherein a cat is eaten by mice shows us the strange cruelty of Ishii, as well as his philosophy concerning Unit 731. The freezing scenes show us the tedious routine of the experiments, the detached way doctors and soldiers treat their victims, and we also see how the youth corps are desensitized. The vivisection of the child is a tipping point in the film. The lead up to it, the scene itself, and its aftermath gives us a disturbingly intimate insight into the beliefs and attitudes of the researchers. The boys' club nature of the clique of superiors at the facility. We also see how loyal to his superiors Ishikawa is, and how he is crushed by what he has done. This whole part of the film also immediately leads us into seeing the reluctant soldier completely losing his grip, mirroring Ishikawa's emotional development. Another example of this is the recurring character of the cremator. We visit him intermittently to watch him drunkenly chop up bodies for the furnace. But no matter how much he butchers and burns, corpses are always crowding the room. It is a grim scene in a grisly life. We only ever see him in here, stuck with his gruesome Sisyphean task. Within the crematorium, the Maruta are finally realized as such, as logs for a fire. They are here treated the way they are described, yet in this environment the denial is overbearing. Not even the furnace operator can cope. You can call people what you like, treat people however you like, think of them how you will. These are all people. These are all human bodies. This is a theme we return to throughout the film. The way the Japanese treated others was a reflection of how they treated each other. You can't ever dehumanize selectively, not truly. When we dehumanize anyone, we invariably dehumanize all of humanity, including ourselves. Even if we and our own remain, in our eyes, more human than most, we are still less human as a result. The film ends in an eruption of metaphor and symbolism, bearing down on the viewer like a cudgel. The reluctant Japanese soldier has smuggled one of the prisoners into the group of Japanese fleeing Manchuria. The wife of one of the unit's 731 officers begins to go into labor. There is a fleet of doctors, but no one attends to her, and she is left out in the cold because the cars are loaded up with documents. The same documents that will be used by Shiro Ishii and the doctors of Unit 731 to bargain for immunity with the Americans. The prisoner is found out, revealed to be non-Japanese, identified sharply as a Maruta. He grabs a sword from a nearby soldier, is shot, and cuts the pole of a Japanese flag in half, and, using the now sharp end of the flag, the officer stabs the Chinese boy to death. Blood covers the Japanese flag as the boy stands bloodied on death's door. A Japanese child is born. The mother dies from taking cyanide. All we are left with are the cries of the newborn child as the train disappears into the distance, the Japanese soldier clutching a flag covered in the blood of a child. This is the face of a superior nation. Its people left to die, its children born in the cold, its flag used to kill children. An ideology of superiority is inevitably an ideology of violence, and culture, nation, people, tradition, in the hands of such an ideology, everything is narrowed to a sharp point. Everything is reduced to a weapon. Men Behind the Sun is rightly infamous for its violence, but the film spends most of its runtime developing characters and educating the viewer in history. Throughout the film, we are regularly treated to displays of misery and gore, but the essence of the film does not lie simply in declaring all this horror objectionable, but in contextualizing these horrors, and in so doing, showing us how they are perfectly human. The film's title even suggests this. The film has been distributed under several titles, but even the more commonly used one, Men Behind the Sun, is not the one favored by director T.F. Mu. His favorite title was the one suggested by his wife, Man Behind the Sun, because it was not a story about the Japanese so much as a story about humanity. What the Japanese did is something that humans do. The people who committed all these atrocities were human. They were professionals, doctors, nurses, scientists, soldiers. All but the youth corps volunteered, knowing full well what they were in for, and they did not do so because they were inhuman monsters. We can drown our focus in Shiro Ishii and his seeming sociopathy, but there were not only many other directors within the program and many other facilities, but also thousands of professionals fully aware of what they were doing, seeing as how they were doing it on a daily basis for years. These same people would return to civil service and positions of high scientific esteem after the war. The Americans, having cordially accepted their research documents, would grant immunities and hush it all up, claiming the existence of the BW program was a Soviet conspiracy and smear campaign. Only in the Soviet Union were trials held against a mere 12 members of the Japanese army, the so-called Khabarovsk war crimes trials. The atrocities committed by the Japanese were not some uniquely Japanese phenomena. It was a human phenomena, aligned with our species' vast collection of unspeakable atrocities. The Japanese did nothing more or less horrible than what any of the Allied nations had done repeatedly throughout their history. In comparison to the atrocities committed by the Allied nations before and after World War II, the Japanese Biological Weapons Research Program is small fry. This fact does not absolve anyone from what they have done, nor do I want to seem as though I'm suggesting the nation of Japan does not carry a guilt which it has yet to acknowledge and atone for. My point is that it is convenient and comfortable to mentally contain the worst of our species to certain peoples, or nations, or cultures, or times.
La nation se construit comme un stade ou un grand hôtel, avec des entrepreneurs, des devis, de la concurrence, sans doute des pots de vin. Pas de style imposé, c'est laissé à l'imagination. Style alpin, style garage, style japonais, sans style. Les architectes inventent calmement ces porches destinés à n'être franchis qu'une seule fois.
This is a film called Night and Fog. It is 30 minutes long. There are some movies that I think all people should watch. This is one of them.
Au moment où je vous parle, l'eau froide des marais et des ruines remplit le creux des charniers. Une eau froide et opaque comme notre mauvaise mémoire. La guerre s'est assoupie. Un œil toujours ouvert. L'herbe fidèle est venue à nouveau sur les Appelplatz, autour des blocs. Un village abandonné, encore plein de menaces. Le crématoire est hors d'usage. Les ruses nazies sont démodées. 9 millions de morts hantent ce paysage. Qui de nous veille de cet étrange observatoire pour nous avertir de l'avenue des nouveaux bourreaux? Ont-ils vraiment un autre visage que le nôtre? Quelque part parmi nous, il reste des capots chanceux, des chefs récupérés, des dénonciateurs inconnus. Il y a tous ceux qui n'y croyaient pas, ou seulement de temps en temps. Il y a nous qui regardons sincèrement ces ruines, comme si le vieux monstre concentrationnaire était mort sous les décombres, qui feignons de reprendre espoir devant cette image qui s'éloigne, comme si on guérissait de la peste concentrationnaire. Nous qui feignons de croire que tout cela est d'un seul temps et d'un seul pays, et qui ne pensons pas à regarder autour de nous, et qui n'entendons pas qu'on crie sans fin.
Just as it is comforting to contain the worst of our species to nations, we frequently do the same to individuals. We love a villain, someone to pin the unspeakable on and contain within them. Better yet, if we can also apply to them some aspect that makes them other. Perhaps they are a sexual deviant or flamboyant. Perhaps their behavior is a bit off. Maybe they're mentally ill. An anomaly within our species, not like us, not like normal people. I've seen this in a few places where I have read about the Japanese PW program. Karosa even says it in his interview with Mu.
It's definitely interesting because I feel like a lot of the people responsible for this kind of thing were psychopaths, you know? You know, a clinically diagnosable psychopath, you totally depict Ishii as that, you know?
You can believe Shiro Ishii to be some unhinged psychopath, if you like, a villain and a monster without which none of this would have happened. Or he was just a rich kid. A man born into immense privilege and wealth, who sought to express and garner power. And isn't that what we expect from the powerful? Are the rich any different now? I think there is an unspoken reason for why human beings have yet to form egalitarian societies. Why the idea of egalitarianism, the idea that all humans are equal, is so grossly unappealing to so many people. Because if we are all equal, then you have to admit that you're just like everyone else. It is certainly uncomfortable to consider the fact that perhaps a person capable of live vivisection on a daily basis is not only sane, but just as human as yourself. Men Behind the Sun shows how, when they are at their best, disturbing films become invaluable. This is part of their appeal, I think. There just really isn't anything like a good disturbing film. It has the power to confront things in a way few films can. The story of Men Behind the Sun is not a melodrama. This is not a tale of good versus evil, but neither is it a cowardly tale about some grey apolitical morality. It is a story about the humanity of blatant cruelty. About the uncomfortable truths of our being. I do not think these truths are eternal, but I also don't think they belong solely to history, as we remain far from overcoming them. If Men Behind the Sun could be called an exploitation film, then it could only be one in a way which would radically alter what we include in the genre. T.F. Moo did not think he made an exploitation film, and neither do I. But I also don't think this is a horror film, or a drama, or a docudrama. It is something else, as is so often the case with films canonized into the genre of the disturbing. I think we can all agree that genre is a silly thing, arbitrary and largely irrelevant. But I do think it is worthwhile to consider why films are lumped into some genres rather than others, as I hope the beginning of this video illustrated. It is comforting to not take seriously and dismiss the story of Men Behind the Sun, and it is comforting in the same way to dismiss it into the genre of exploitation film. If there is anything that truly marks a good disturbing film, it is its inability to comfort the viewer. But this does not equate to nihilism, but to discomfort. There is nothing wrong with entertainment, with comforting media. We all need it, perhaps more than we should have to need it. But now and then, when you have it in you, go watch Men Behind the Sun and enjoy your discomfort.